Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
And it's been another week of Flames hockey and another interesting week for Flames fans. As usual, I'm Dan alongside Matt. Matt, can you sum up this week in one word?
Confusing, and yeah, it's one of those situations where they're finding different and interesting ways to lose.
Which is totally the opposite of what we were saying last year, where they're finding different interesting ways to win.
Exactly. It's like all the luck has gone in the exact opposite direction.
We got all the luck we were going to have for the whole rebuild last year. Well, let's talk about the four games this week and how the Flames did and some of our thoughts on each one. On Tuesday of last week, the Flames started their road trip in Florida against your second favorite team, the Panthers. And I was hoping the Flames were going to annihilate the Panthers in this one. And it ended up being a 4-3 final finished in regulation. There was no overtime on that. What are your thoughts on that Panthers game, Matt?
That was a game where it was mainly the goaltending that cost us in that one. And the whole team just kind of was there. I didn't see like any real inspirational play from anybody. It seemed like every time the Flames were getting going, a bad goal would go in and that would just deflate the team.
In that game, I thought that the Flames had a good start to the game. I thought they came out playing more energy than Florida did. And I'm not sure they got worse. I've heard from a lot of people they did. I think Florida just got better as the game went on and eventually rose to the Flames level, and they have a better roster. So when they're rising to, you know, their 100%, their 100% seems to be better than our 100%. Would you agree?
Yeah. I don't understand why this Flames team seems to have lost all their mojo from last year. They didn't really lose anybody of note in the organization, and yet all their depth seems to have vanished.
Well, we'll talk about that a bit later on. But, you know, when I look at this game, I think one of the interesting things, the Monahan power play goal, I thought was one of the best offensive plays we've had this year. It was a nice, smart play in front. The whole line seemed to be on the ball and ready to go. And I thought that, especially for a goalie like Luongo, that was a nice play and a nice shift overall.
Yeah, the Flames, their power play has been getting better after being, basically, you could just fast forward the clock 2 minutes in the first 10 or 15 games. It just hasn't been clicking as much as the Flames need. And on that Monahan goal, it was a very good play, and the Flames were actually able to capitalize.
And then the Yager goal, that was the one in the third period. That Yager goal was just Florida doing everything right in front of the net. And I don't know if the Flames defense just got overwhelmed or what happened, but there should have been more coverage on Yager on that play. Like, I was surprised that that one went in.
Yeah, and that was one of the slowest shots I think I've ever seen get past an NHL goaltender.
Yeah, well, Yager's getting old. He doesn't have the same shots as he used to.
Well, even then, looked like Myra's shot.
And I think the interesting thing about that game, if we can take something good away, was I thought David Jones, of all people, was playing a really good game. And for a guy that, you know, looked pretty good last year, I wouldn't say that he was one of the best players last year, but we talked about everyone was having career years last year. I thought Jones was doing really well and getting two goals against the Panthers. We're really seeing him start to step it up.
Yeah, he hasn't collected an assist yet, I think, this season, but his willingness to crash the net and do all the little things to generate offense is there.
I still don't think that David Jones is worth what we're paying him, but I think that we're starting to see good play from him so far. He's got 6 goals and 0 assists, but I think between last year and this year, he's looking like a more solid addition. When he first came here at $4 million, we all said, nah, he's not worth it. Just get rid of him. But to me, he's looking more like a core guy for this team.
Yeah, he's played significantly better since his first injury-filled season. I wouldn't re-sign him to $4 million, but if the Flames did offer him a contract, in the 2-2-5 range, that wouldn't be the end of the world.
Yeah, I was going to say, not a core guy I want back for what he'll probably get on the open market, but I think even more than signing him, there might be better trade value for him this year, especially as a rental.
Oh, for sure. And any team could use a quality third, fourth line guy that can chip in. Well, I think he's got 6 goals now.
6 goals, 0 assists.
Yeah, so I could see him having a somewhat similar return as Glenn Cross did last season if he keeps it up the rest of the way.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. I would toss him an offer in the offseason. I wouldn't offer him nearly what he's getting paid. That wasn't our deal. That was a deal that we inherited with him.
Oh, for sure.
From Colorado. And I don't think we ever would have paid him that much, but he had a long-term deal from Colorado when we got him, and I think, yeah, throw him a deal at, you know, 2-2-5. If he takes it, great. If someone else offers him more, then let him go there.
Exactly. And with how the offseason went with Curtis Glenn Cross not being signed and just retiring, who knows what next year's free agent market will be.
It's a good point. You might get some agents to just tell their guy, just take the first deal that comes in. You know, if someone's going to offer you a deal, even if it's not what you want, it gets you more NHL time. Because Glennie's officially retired now, right?
Yes.
That's what I thought. So after the loss in Florida, the Flames took a day off on Wednesday. They traveled to Tampa Bay, stayed in the state of Florida, but traveled over to Tampa Bay on Thursday where they played the Lightning. And that was another disappointing loss. The Flames outshot the Lightning 31-29, but ended up losing the game 3-1. What are your thoughts on that one?
And this is where the Flames are finding different ways to lose. The Florida game, it was mostly on Ramo. The Tampa game, it was all the defense. And you just simply can't allow a team as skilled as Tampa the amount of opportunities in on net. Ramo played really well in that game.
I thought that might have been Ramo's best game this season.
Yeah, and
it could have been the best Flames goaltending performance this season.
Yeah, and the Flames just, they couldn't generate any offense. Credit Ben Bishop for being huge and just getting in the way of all the pucks that the Flames directed at him. And, yeah, just another one of those games where if the Flames were playing better, they could have won. They didn't. And, you know, they walk away with another zero-point effort.
I was pretty impressed that the Flames were able to keep Tampa off the score sheet for the first period.
Yeah. Well, the first 10 minutes in that game, it was pretty much a turkey shoot in the Flames zone. And I'm surprised that Calgary didn't surrender 2 or 3 goals in that game, in that stretch.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. I think it's good that for what they were getting, the Flames were able to come out strong, keep the Lightning out of their net. But then as soon as Brian Boyle scored pretty much to start the second, I think from there it's pretty much over.
Yeah.
We started to see Tampa. It's like, okay, it's like a cat chasing its mouse. Okay, we're done playing with you guys now. Now it's time to turn it on.
Yeah, somewhat similar to the Chicago game that we'll be talking about in a few minutes.
Exactly. So another disappointing loss there. The next night, the Flames traveled from Florida on Friday to Washington, where they took on Alexander Ovechkin and the Washington Capitals. Got outshot here, 29-36 by the Capitals, but ended up finding a way to win this one in a 3-2 win. I think the most interesting thing to me was that the Flames played Karri Ramo back-to-back. I mean, yes, they got a good performance out of the night before, but, and we'll talk more about this later, but it makes me wonder what the thought about Joni Ortio is at this point.
Yeah. Well, the Flames, they got out to a lead in the third period, 2-0 lead, and they just sat back and allowed Washington to take over the game, and were lucky that Washington only tied the game and didn't win it before it even headed to overtime.
Yeah, and in the end of the third there, I thought for a long time that Washington was going to put it away.
Oh, so was I. Like, as soon as the second goal was scored, I'm like, okay, where's the third one? Just waiting for...
Exactly, I felt the same way.
Like, how are you going to screw this one up type of thing? And
that's it. We had our lead. The other teams come back. This generally means that we're done. Just put us out of our misery and let's go home.
Yeah, But they did manage to find a way to collect the 2 points. Monahan with the overtime winner.
His sixth of the season from Brody and Hamilton.
Yeah. This team, and I'll discuss this more after we wrap the Chicago game, but they just seem to be so mentally fragile.
Yeah, well, mentally fragile, I think just not playing smart hockey. Like, one of the things I have in my notes here is I thought that Johnny needed to improve his positioning in front of the net. There was a few times where the puck was given to him and he was in front of the net, but his stick was up or he wasn't quite in the right spot, and we lost out on some good chances because of it. And it's those little things that, especially for a number one line forward,
yeah,
he needs to be doing properly.
I know. He didn't collect a single point on the road trip, and yeah, that when you don't have your star player contributing, going 1-3 on the road trip, it makes sense.
So the Flames took Saturday off. They spent some time traveling, and they ended up on Sunday yesterday in Chicago to take on the Big Bad Blackhawks. This was the game that a lot of people were interested to see how we were going to do against the Blackhawks. They are, the big NHL powerhouse here. And we ended up playing the Blackhawks in Chicago, and we got annihilated 4-1. And in this game, as everybody probably knows by now, Chicago scored 3 goals in 2 minutes, which pretty much put the Flames away. What are your thoughts on this game?
Well, realistically, for how the first 30 minutes went in the hockey game, if you would have said the score was 3-1 Chicago, it wouldn't have mattered that all the goals came in the 2 minutes. That's how the game looked. In the first period, I don't even think the Flames had more than one shot in the first 17 minutes. And Karri Ramo was playing his best, but there's only so much that one person can do.
Yeah, I thought that the Flames did as good as they could based on what we're seeing this year. It looked like a typical Calgary Flames 2015 effort. They sort of came out, they had some bright spots, but they couldn't string together 60 minutes of hockey. And Chicago, being the powerhouse they are, just overwhelmed us. And again, surprising that we kept them off the score sheet for the first period. But when they got their 3 goals in the second, I probably would have changed my goalie at that point, given Ortio some time, which we didn't. But that was pretty much the end. As soon as they got 3 goals in 2 minutes, I thought, yeah, this one's done.
Yeah, and realistically, this was the game that, to me, exemplified how the Flames are just a mentally weak team this year. In the second period, they got a fluky lead after the David Jones goal, and one mistake by Derek Englund just completely unraveled the team.
Yeah.
He kind of didn't make an accurate pass out of his zone. It got turned over, and instead of the team responding properly to contain the puck, it ends up on Patrick Kane's stick, and the goal scored, and the Flames just completely were shell-shocked after that, and two more quick ones followed, and that's the ballgame. And a team that is mentally tough would have just said, okay, we screwed up, big deal. Puck drops, let's go have a good energy shift in the other zone. They didn't do that.
Yeah, this whole road trip, the Flames seem like south of their own blue line. There's no game. They look like Edmonton. They just have no defensive game.
Yeah, and like on the Panarin goal, TJ Brody, instead of going to one knee while sweeping at the puck from Kane, he just got himself out of position, leaving Panarin wide open behind him. If you're not blocking the passing lane with your leg, a guy like Kane, he's going to find the hole in between your feet even to find the passing lane. And you can't leave a guy like Panarin out in front all by himself.
I thought that in the Chicago game, to give the Flames some credit, I thought they had some decent chances. They had some puck luck that didn't go their way. I think if they got lucky on some of those, the score could have been higher in favor of the Flames. But, in the end, the effort didn't show, and they got what they deserved.
Yeah, and realistically, when you have a team that is struggling, as the Flames have been, you need somebody to do something to stand out. Like last year, there was one game where Lance Boma, I think it was the game against Washington early in the season, and he went and he hit one of the Capitals players, and then the Flames were shorthanded shortly after, and he blocked like three or four shots, and the Flames started to play significantly better following that. Well, this year, there's nobody throwing that big hit or making those key blocks to pump up the rest of the team. Everybody's just kind of like, oh, I can't make any mistakes, otherwise we're going to lose, and mistakes happen and they lose.
So I know you heard it and I heard it today. It's November 15th or 16th on the radio. Anyone can listen to it. It's on demand at Fan 960. You could hear that even Rhett Warrener was starting to get frustrated by this team. And Warrener, I think, said it best. He said, we have to stop making excuses for the Flames. You know, you can say, well, the goaltending was good, or well, they played a tough team. But at some point, you've got to put up or shut up. And, you know, after I listened to Warrener say that this morning, I went back and I looked at the season so far and the Flames' performances so far. And honestly, I feel like, except for maybe one or two games, the Flames have got pretty much what they deserve all year. The games they put in a good effort, they've won. Every other game where the effort hasn't been there, they've, you know, they've got exactly what they deserve. And sometimes they've got 1 point they didn't deserve even. But, you know, it makes me wonder, like, if you look at the core of this team, Matt, we haven't, it's not like we've had wholesale changes since last year. Only two or three guys are different. So it makes you wonder, why the change in attitude?
I honestly have no idea. And, like, outside of perhaps some injuries that fans and ourselves included don't know about, that's pretty much the only thing that I can think of that would explain, like, say, like, Mark Giordano not looking 100% from his arm injury.
It's funny you mention that, because I was thinking that during the Chicago game. I thought, Gio doesn't look like he should. He looks like there's still something going on there.
Yeah, and, like, he can play. He's playing about at the same level he did prior to becoming the Flames captain. Just the quality 3-4 guy that's okay, but not great. And who knows if there aren't other injuries or such in the team. It's just, the lack of heart and the willingness to make mistakes. Like, I think, like, everybody on the team is just gripping their sticks way too hard and, like, so scared that if they make a mistake, the puck's going to end up in their net.
But it is anyways.
Oh, I know. But they have, if they relax on the ice and just let their game, them play their game, they will play better. It's just, they're so worried about focusing on all the little details that it's causing more mistakes to happen. And it's just a big snowball effect where one thing doesn't go right and then, like, the whole team implodes.
And, I mean, just looking down the roster at the guys that weren't here last year. So we have Michael Frolik.
Yeah.
Derek Grant. And Dougie Hamilton.
Yeah, I guess.
And that's really it. Maybe we could maybe say Lottie Smead as well. But everybody, you know, we got, what, four guys of 23? Like, to me, this is the same Flames team that we saw last year. And why, I didn't expect a playoff performance, but I'm just trying to figure out why such a terrible performance. It's almost like everything they worked for is just down the drain. And I agree with you that, you know, they need to be taking more risks and they need to be trying some new things. But I think, I don't know, it just seems like they've lost their whole identity this year. This team is looking like the Flames did under Keenan, where we had no idea what anyone was doing. Everyone just went out there and did their own thing and nobody seemed to care. And that's, you know, the years when we seemed to have a bunch of freelancers who all happened to be wearing the same Flames jersey.
Yeah, you have 23 players pulling in 23 directions instead of everybody on the same page last year.
Exactly. And, you know, I mean, last year we got lucky. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, no.
We definitely got lucky. But we should be doing, I mean, based looking at this team on paper, you know, you got Sam Bennett, you got Frolik, you got Hudler, you got, you know, Monahan, Raymond, Brody, Giordano, Hamilton, Russell, Weidman, You know, you've got Hiller and Ramo. Like, why are we doing so terrible? I guess I'm at the point with this team where I've tried to make excuses, and I agree with Warrener that at this point we can't keep making excuses. Like, we have to figure out something is wrong here, and somebody has to figure out what it is.
Yeah, and like, I know some people have suggested firing the coaching staff, and
we talked about that a couple weeks ago.
And I don't understand how things can be so opposite when there hasn't been any real change. And it's not like Frolik and Hamilton have come in and played so bad that they're dragging the whole team down. In fact, I would
argue that Frolik has been one of the guys that's been doing better than the rest of the team.
Yeah, he's been pretty much the best of the secondary players on the team.
And we're starting to see Hamilton come around, I think.
Yeah, since the Ottawa game when TJ Brody returned, I think Hamilton started playing significantly better in that game. And moving forward, he's been increasingly better with each passing game, to the point where right now I think that him and Brody are pretty much neck and neck for the best defenseman on the team. It's just when you have so many things screwing up all at the same time, it's hard to put a finger on, oh, it's this one thing that's causing all of it. And until certain things can be sorted out and modified or improved through better performance, like, say, the goaltending, you just have to roll with it and see who responds and how they respond.
But I don't even think at this point we can say anymore like we did at the beginning, it's the goaltending. It's everybody. You know, we've had great nights from the goalie, and the rest of the team's put out a terrible night. We've had good nights from the team, and the goalie's been terrible. Like, you know, we could fix the goaltending, and I don't think we're necessarily going to fix the Flames' problem.
No, and like, if you look at Ramo's save percentage lately, like, I think he had a .923 save percentage against Chicago. Well, it's clearly not his fault that the team's playing bad. So, like, in the early part of the season, yes, the goaltending, all three of them were terrible. Now, the goaltending's improved. So, what's the problem? And
well, that's it. And I feel like, let's just assume, because his name's been bandied around there, let's say the Flames go and make a big acquisition for someone like a Cam Ward.
No.
I don't think this team turns around just because now we have a different goalie.
No. And I honestly don't think even if you made three or four big trades that it would change anything.
It seems to be that there's a problem from within, and, you know, maybe Hartley's lost the room. I tend to doubt that because you have so many guys who seem to have been so deep in Hartley's system last year. It's not like they were barely hanging on. These guys seem like, you know, anything Hartley said, they did. Anytime Hartley said jump, they said how high. And you don't go one summer and have,
okay, screw that guy. Yeah.
Yeah, and go, oh, that coach was pretty dumb last year. We made it to the second round of the playoffs, but what does he know? Let's not do what he says this year. It's not like we've changed assistants where maybe there's a bad coach in the room. Like, I'm trying to look at what's been changed. And to me, there hasn't been the changes you would expect for this to be happening. So I'm just kind of puzzled as to what the heck's going on.
Yeah. And it seems like all the young players that are on the team, Bennett, Gaudreau, Monahan, Brody, and Hamilton, are the good players on the team. It seems like all the veteran guys that you should be counting on to more or less play at a proficient level have completely fallen off the map. And
as we've talked about before, I don't believe, as we've seen in Edmonton, that you can have a team of just the young guys.
No.
You need those older guys. And if I look at the older guys we have, you know, guys like Frolik, guys like Hudler, you know, even a guy like Stajan, I think you've got the right core of veterans to go with our young guys, and it's a matter of, so why is it not working?
Yeah, and that's why the team will just have to be patient and work through the problems and just carry on. There's not any quick or easy solution where you can just go, oh, I'll shuffle the lines this way, and magically all the problems are going to be fixed. Everybody on the team just seems to be off entirely, and how that turns around it'll be the story of the rest of the season.
And, you know, you were saying earlier, maybe it has to do with injuries. And one of the things I've noticed is it seems like the Flames aren't penalizing for bad play. I mean, last year we'd see a guy get a terrible game and they'd sit him, or they'd, you know, reduce his minutes. And it seems like there's no accountability this year. Maybe that's the biggest thing. You can have a terrible game like Mason Raymond and you're back in the lineup the next night. And it's like, with the number of forwards, especially we have at the AHL level, why are we not sitting these guys down or demoting them or, you know, bringing somebody up to take their spot? It seems like we're the coaching staff, and maybe it's the GM, I don't know how far it goes, they're promoting the mediocrity. They're saying, well, you played a terrible game, but that's okay, do it again. Like, I think maybe part of the problem is that we're not saying that was terrible. Sit down and think about what you've done, and someone else is going to go into the lineup. We saw that last year with great success. Remember when they benched, what was it? They benched
Weidman.
Goudreau.
Weidman.
And they came back and had a great season after that.
Yeah.
And we all talked about maybe that was Hartley's key.
Well, yeah, part of the problem is the main difference between last year and this year is that the team didn't really have any fixed spots. And anybody that came in and played well, they'd earn the spots. This year, pretty much every spot on the team was accounted for. And it didn't really matter how good or bad you played. You're heading to Stockton if you're not on the team, and that's it.
If you're not in a one-way deal, you're off to Stockton.
Yeah, and like a guy like, say, Marcus Granlund, he should have been here to start the season. But because there was too many veterans on the team, he can clear and go to the farm without having to go through waivers, he's gone. But
you look at a guy like Raymond, who they put on waivers, he cleared, and now they have the option to send him down. He's playing like crap, and he's still here, and I'm trying to figure out why they've decided, okay, you're playing terrible. I mean, he's got one goal and 1 point in 10 games. He's a -4. You know, like, why is he still here? Why have they not said, wow, you're doing terrible? Even if they don't send him down, bench him and pull somebody up and say, this is your spot. And I think that's one of the great things we saw last year was young players had that chance to earn the spot, and I'm confused why we've changed that mentality.
Well, like, if you look at a similar player in a similar situation last year, Devin Setoguchi, he played the first 12 games of the season. It wasn't working out, and they got rid of him. And he went to the AHL, never to be heard from again. And with Raymond, he had one goal thus far, and every game that he's played, it's been not a good performance. And yet the Flames, like, they assigned Derek Grant to Stockton, which we'll be talking about later more so. He was playing good. And instead of Raymond going, Grant goes. Well, how is that always earned, never given mantra being followed when you have a player that's actually playing well that gets assigned because whatever reason, and a guy like Raymond, who has played terrible, is still on the team?
Exactly. You know, and that to me is frustrating. Like you said, that, you know, always earned, never given. Like, we have guys here who have not earned the chance to play at the NHL level, I think. And if you look on the farm, I mean, we got guys like Granlund, who's got 8 points, Freddie Hamilton, who's got 6 points, Agostino's got 6. Like, bring some of these guys up and let them at least have a shot. I'm not saying that Granlund's going to save the team or Freddie Hamilton's going to save the team, but put that competitive edge that we saw last year back in, where last year, if you didn't play well, someone was going to take your job.
Yeah, and now it's like it doesn't matter if you're playing good, bad, or you're just there, you're going to be playing the next game.
As long as you have a contract that's one way, you're wearing a flaming C.
And that's where what this team needs to get away from is that lack of accountability. Because, like you've mentioned in the past, like, Karri Ramo played better when he had competition in the net. Well, it seemed like all the players on the Flames last year, they played better because there was legitimately having everybody...
They're playing for their jobs.
There was nobody's spot that was guaranteed cemented in, except for maybe a couple of guys like Hudler and Giordano.
Well, even a guy like Bennett, I mean, there's talk of sending him, you know, back for another year. So he had to even prove that he deserved the NHL.
Yeah, and it's just frustrating because some of the formula that worked last year isn't really being adhered to. And whether that's the direct cause or not, it's something that they should return to at least moving forward through the rest of the season.
Yeah, and when you look at, I mean, you know, we talked about the coaching staff, but even when we look at the office, I mean, Brian Burke, I've always thought that Brian Burke is one of the, I always respected him as a GM, and I always thought that Brian Burke was a no-nonsense guy, and, you know, I know Berkey's not the GM, but if Berkey was the GM, there's no way he would stand for this. You know, if we have guys who aren't playing, Berkey's the kind of guy that says, get out of here, go to the AHL, I'll bring somebody else up. So it makes you wonder why Treliving is letting this stand.
Yeah. I know, and
you know, it's not like our owners are, the owners have to pay Raymond either way. I think that Calgary wants competitive hockey. We don't have to be a playoff team, but I can't see the owners complaining if we want to send $2.5 million to Stockton.
No, and like one of the things that the Flames will have to do at moving forward the rest of the season is evaluating the guys that are on the older side of the prospect pool, guys like Augustino, Arnold, and Granlund, those guys are going to need some time in the NHL this season. Just to be sure that, like, if you're going to keep them in the organization or not. And, you know, if you re-sign them and you lose them on waivers, are you going to be worried about that? Because I do believe Arnold and Granlund have to pass through waivers next year. So the Flames do need to make a verdict on those guys. And yet they're not getting an opportunity in the NHL to actually show whether or not they're an NHL player. It's just frustrating, that's all.
Yeah, I have no doubt that eventually those guys will be coming up because I have no doubt that moves are going to happen. I don't think at this point trading and making a big deal, whether for a forward or defenseman or a netminder, is going to fix the Flames' woes.
No.
But I think that, and this is kind of going back on what I said earlier, and we talked about this earlier, you and I had a bit of an argument over this. At the time, I didn't think it was time to start making big moves. I didn't want to trade a guy like Yuri Hudler yet or David Jones yet because I still felt the season could be salvaged. At this point, I think realistically, okay, yes, theoretically we could, but realistically, there's no way we can make the playoffs now. Would you agree?
Well, it would. The only way that the Flames could get in is if in the next 20 games they win 15 of them. And that sounds absolutely ridiculous, and it is. But the Flames are so far behind the eight ball that even though we're in the worst division in the NHL, it is really tough to make up points. And, like, we're only 6 points out of a playoff spot right now. And, like, on the surface you go, oh, well, that's only 3 wins. But you have to figure that the other team's gonna, if you say win 3 in a row, the other team's gonna likely win 1 or 2 of those games themselves. So you,
and yes, it's 3 wins, but we only have 2 regulation wins in the first 19 games.
Exactly. And it's,
which means we've got to get not only 3 wins, that means we got to get 6 overtimes.
Yeah.
And lose that way. Like, it's just, it, yes, it could happen, but really, if we're going at the pace we're going, we're in 19 games, we have 2 wins, we're not going to get 15 of the next 20, especially if you look at the teams we've got. I mean, we got New Jersey, we got the Devils.
Well, realistically, the only team that between now and January 1st that's terrible is Edmonton. Everybody else is either 500 or better, pretty much. So, other than, I think, Anaheim. So, we're kind of screwed in terms of easy competition. And, yeah, it's not a good place.
And every time we see the Flames have a great game, and every time I look around and say, okay, they can build on this, they don't.
No.
You know, we've had one stint where we had 2 wins in a row, and otherwise we're getting good games. Like, I'd even say, you know, this past week, the Washington game, okay, we got a big win, let's build on it. And then we go to Chicago and we drop, you know, 4-1 to the Hawks. So, you know, we had two wins earlier this month against the Flyers and the Penguins. It's like, hey, our momentum's going. And then we lost to the, you know, to the
Panthers and the Lightning.
Panthers. So, you know, to me, there's no way we can win 15 of 20.
No. And realistically, if you're in a position where you basically have to play like the President's Trophy winning team the rest of the way, and there's 60 plus games left just to make the playoffs, that's just not going to happen. And like, it doesn't matter how optimistic you are, it just doesn't work that way, unfortunately. And this season for the Flames is pretty much done in terms of the playoffs. Now, that can change if they do go on this massive winning streak, but you have to put up or shut up, as you said earlier.
Well, I can't remember the last time that our team won 15 of 20.
No. Like, we'd have to basically play like the Minnesota Wild did after they acquired Dubnyk the rest of the way. And, yeah, that's...
And looking at this team, we're not even close to that.
No, not at all. And,
you know, it's not like we're right on the verge of it, or we're winning four and then losing one.
No.
It'll probably take them, let's say in best case scenario, it takes them till the end of the month to get whatever's wrong figured out.
You're too far away now. And
yeah,
it's, you're done.
I don't want to say it's time to blow up this team by any stretch, but I think we have a lot of UFA pieces that, again, earlier in the season, I'm going back on what I said earlier, because earlier we still had a chance. I didn't want to dismantle this team too early.
No.
To me, at this point, there's no chance to make the playoffs realistically. Yes, mathematically, it's possible. Realistically, this team's not making the playoffs here and doesn't need to. So if the right deal comes along for a UFA piece, you move it.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter which UFA piece or veteran piece.
Jari Hudler's not going to do us much good for the rest of the season. So if we can find a home for him, move him, and bring one of the younger guys you were mentioning onto the roster to give him some playtime.
Yeah, and if there's a deal out there where a player like, say, Michael Backlund has to be included in it because you're getting a foundational piece moving forward, so?
Yeah, well, as we've talked about in the past, if the right deal comes, you always take it. But if I was the GM, I would not be shopping Backlund at this point.
No, but it's one of those things, you listen to everything now.
Right. You'd be foolish not to. You'd lose your job.
And unless the trade involves Gaudreau, Monahan, Bennett, Brody, or Hamilton, anybody else, to me, if the right deal comes along that makes sense, you pull the trigger.
Right. So, I mean, of course, if the right deal comes, you pull the trigger. But if I'm looking at, if I'm Treliving and I'm trying to convince someone to take my players, a guy like Backlund's not someone I'd be actively shopping. I think at 26, Backlund's a decent, third line piece. But I think the first guys I'm looking at moving are guys like Russell, Hudler, Jones, the guys who are UFAs, who we're going to lose anyways.
Yeah.
And you just have to decide as the GM, are you going to get more value trying to find a buyer now? Or wait until the end of the year. And to me, if you've got a, even if it's maybe not the best deal, I think there's some value to moving at least one of those guys out early to bring a young piece up and say, you know what, now that we're in rebuild mode, our primary focus is player development.
Yeah, exactly.
We're not trying for a postseason now. We're trying to develop young players. And while, yes, maybe we can get a better deal for a guy like, I wouldn't move Hudler yet because I think there's a big market for Hudler at the deadline. Same thing with Russell, but maybe a guy like, Jones is exactly what I was thinking. You know, you move Jones, you bring a guy like Granlund up, and you say, all right, you're in the NHL, time to develop you. And if you don't play great, that's fine, but let's see what you got.
Yeah. And the
whole league even.
Yeah, exactly. Like anybody that's not stapled down, if the right deal makes sense, move them out.
Right, and I would never argue with you, Matt, that if the right deal comes, you don't move a guy. I think any GM would tell you that. Any fan would tell you that, right? That's their job. But it's a matter of who are you trying to move and what deals would be looking for, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if the right deal comes, you would even move Monahan. You know, if the right deal comes, any guy is available. It's just a matter of the price. And I can't think of the price for Monahan, but if somebody wanted to clean up the new arena spot and build us a building, maybe you trade him.
I wouldn't go that far.
you know, but I think, yes, anyone's available for the right price. But if you look at who you're actively trying to shop, I think now is the time in the year where I would be comfortable saying, yeah, let's look for deals. You know, earlier I didn't want to blow it up, and now that we're 20 games into the year, it's time.
Yeah. And
I'm not going to move guys for the sake of moving them yet.
No, but
later on, yes.
Yeah.
You know, near the deadline, just get rid of the dead weight and move on. But I think now it's just if the deal comes up.
Yeah, like anytime after January, that's pretty much when I think you'll start seeing trades being made.
Yeah, as teams start to sort of finalize their place in the standings, we know who's looking at a wild card spot and who needs to jump up. That's where I think teams are going to have a desire to make a move with the Flames. And I honestly don't think you need to move anyone but the UFAs. I don't want to see anybody walk out of here for nothing this year. If your contract's over and you're not coming back, deal them for something. But I don't want to see a Camilleri.
Oh yeah, and
let somebody walk for nothing. We can't afford that right now.
No, asset maximization is the key.
Exactly. It's not blowing it up. It's just moving the pieces that need to be moved and shifting our focus. It's saying, you know what? The focus is no longer the postseason. The focus is now player development. And, you know, a guy like Hudler has a usefulness as long as he's here, which is help develop those young players. You know, make Goudreau and Monahan look great. You know, a guy like Stajan, same thing. You know, Russell, same thing. But, you know, you're not in our long-term plans.
Mm-hmm.
And let's start looking at who's going to replace them. Be that inside the organization, be that outside the organization. I think maybe one of those guys gets signed. We've talked about this before, but if you're not in the plans, I think it's time to shift the focus at this point, which is young players, but it can't be all young players. There has to still be a mix. And I think you're going to see guys like Backlund at 26, you know, Boma at 25, Colborne at 25, Frolik at 27. I think you're going to start to see for a transitional period here, those become the elder statesmen on the team.
Yeah, and I think, like, especially in this year's free agency, I would not be shocked if the Flames brought in, like, another guy like a Frolik, who's just a solid middle-line player as well, that's more on the veteran side to help bring this team forward.
Well, especially if you look at if you look at the veterans we're going to lose, I mean, let's just assume for a sec that we don't re-sign any UFAs, just kind of look at the worst-case scenario. So if we take a look at the worst-case scenario and what we could do, really you're going to be getting rid of most of the vets on the team. I think the only one that stays on the forward side, we have what? We have Jones leaves, Hudler leaves, Stajan stays and Raymond stays. And those are all the guys over 30. And then on the defense, you have pretty much only Russell leaving.
Yeah.
And Smead leaves too, right?
No. Smead and Englund have one more after this.
Oh, no, you're right. Smead has... Right. So really, you have Russell leaving. I think we can fill Russell's spot with someone from the farm.
And or UFA.
Because we still have a lot of...
It depends. You know how it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think in a rebuild, we have to start promoting from within. I don't think I would shop UFA yet, unless we move more than one of them out. Let's say we move Smead and Weidman, or Russell and Smead, or something like that. Then maybe we replace one of them. But I think the biggest thing we have to remember is that we're still rebuilding. And as much as we might say, oh, I want this UFA, we've got to start cycling guys through. And if we don't have the guys to cycle through, then we have to maybe trade more assets to get picks to bring those guys in. But if you look at the defensemen we've got right now, I think there's one of them that could step in there. You know, whether it's somebody like
Kulak,
Oliver Shillington, whether it's Morrison, Kulak. I think, you know, and Russell's role doesn't have to be replaced in a top four. You know, maybe you look at a guy like Smead to jump into the top four and you're replacing then a 5-6. But I just don't think you can bring another vet in for that role in a rebuild anyways. If we're running for the playoffs, yeah, for sure. But I think you'll see definitely some veteran depth come in. It'll be interesting to see who. I could see the Flames even target somebody like Luke Shen potentially. But I don't know. I I think it's time just to shift the focus. Maybe Okposo, if they wanted to pay the premium on him, and just say, you know what, we definitely need some veterans, yeah, but right now for this season, it's development time. And maybe that's what you got to do. Is maybe you've got to start. Maybe you've got to start moving these guys when the right deal comes up, and just say, you know what, if you're not, you know, worth your weight here, we're getting rid of you.
Well, the main thing that the Flames have to do moving forward is reallocate the money that's being spent on depth,
yeah,
and spend it on talent.
And we've got two big contracts that are going to be coming up very shortly.
Yeah, like even like next year with Raymond, Smead, England, and Weidman all expiring, you know, that's close to $20 million right there that can be directly shifted towards top six talent.
Yeah, well, that's another reason why I think you have to promote somebody, because if you look at the vets that are out there, you're probably going to be paying more than $1 million for a defenseman, where if we can bring somebody in for sub $1 million, that frees up a lot of cash.
Exactly.
I mean, Russell's making $4 million now. If we could get, say, 3.5 off the books...
Exactly.
It gives us money to play with. So I think, you know, I agree with you that it would be nice to bring some of those guys in, but I don't think we're quite there yet, where when we have a hole, we look to free agency. I think we're at the point where when we have a hole, we look to the farm.
Yeah.
2 years maybe we start doing that, but I think right now we've got enough guys.
It's one of those things that every move that'll be made, it will depend on who, what, where, what, how much, and all that kind of stuff. So, if a guy like, say, Kulak comes in and plays great, you give him the spot. If he is just okay, maybe you look at, you know, more of a veteran guy. We'll have to see how the rest of the way goes.
Yeah, well, that's it. I mean, if nobody impresses, then you look at a veteran. But I can't see with the defensive lineup we've got, even a guy like Nakadal, no. Nobody impressing. Is it? And speaking of trades and the Flames making some trades, we had a trade this week.
When we were in Tampa.
Is it the for the first trade of a struggling season, is this what you expected the Flames to do?
It's not the worst trade. I think with acquiring Kevin Poulin off of Tampa, it made some sense because Gillies apparently needs hip surgery and will be out for a few months. So
let's run through the trade first for everybody. So the Flames acquired goaltender Kevin Poulin from the Tampa Bay Lightning. You probably know him as being an Islanders player. He was with the Islanders for 5 seasons. For those that don't know him, he's 25 years old. He's 6'2", making $600,000 this year. He was a 5th-round pick by the Islanders. His most notable claim in the Sea of Red is he's the guy that Theo Fleury scored on in his return training camp shootout a couple years ago. Matt dug that one up for us.
Yeah, I've always liked Kevin Poulin. When he was with the Islanders, it just never seemed to work out for whatever reason. He's not bad.
I never looked at Poulin as a full-time starter by any means. I've never looked at him as a full-time backup, but I think he'd be a great guy to anchor your AHL.
Yeah, and he's one of those guys that if you needed somebody in the NHL, you could throw him in there. And
he probably would have been a good backup for a guy like Kipper who played 70 games.
Yeah, and
he could mop up the extra 12.
Exactly. The more modern-day version of a guy like Joey McDonald. Just okay. Not bad, not great. He'll do the job.
If we look through the NHL, the most games he's played in a single season was in 2013-2014 with the Islanders. He played 28 games. But he's used to playing 40-50-plus every year. And the Flames acquired him for future consideration. This probably means Trilovin bought breakfast.
Pretty much. If he becomes the Flames starter, the Lightning get a 7th-round pick or something equally absurd.
Well, but then that shows up as conditional, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, but usually the future considerations, there is some mechanism there.
Yeah, so I'm just, hey, next time we trade, remember that you owe me one.
Yeah.
So I'm happy.
I think if I need an AHL defenseman, you know, say I get a whole rash of injuries here, I'll call
you.
You
don't even need to trade
me
one. Just loan me one from your roster or something like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but I think really for giving up nothing, why not get a second AHL goaltender, especially with Gillies hurt right now?
Exactly. Because the worst case scenario is that he struggles in Stockton and you don't keep him beyond this season.
He's only got this year left in his deal.
Exactly. So, oh well.
Matt, we did what we said. We said the Flames had to get rid of guys as rental players. We just brought in a rental goalie.
Yeah, well.
We're going against the rebuild mentality.
Well, situations happen. Like, if, say, Hiller was healthy at the time, I don't think that Poulin would have been acquired. I think
they probably would have just put Ramo back down.
Exactly. And now that Hiller is healthy, it's back to being a bit of a mess.
There's sort of an interesting move, too, because if you know the CBA and if you know how the rules work, so on September 27th, the Islanders placed Poulin on waivers and wanted to assign him to the AHL. He was claimed by the Lightning. Under the waiver rules, if you're claimed on waivers, you have to stay with that team for the entire year, or if they want to waive you, the team that took you gets the first right to refusal. And I bet the Islanders would have happily had this guy back.
Yeah.
So by trading him to the Flames now, those rules, it seems, go out the window, and we can send him down to the A without him even clearing waivers. I'm not sure quite how that works.
Yeah.
He didn't play 10 games. He didn't play a single game with the Islanders. Maybe that's why.
Yeah. I have no idea.
The Lightning. So I thought that's kind of odd. He played one game in 2014-2015 with the Islanders, so probably hasn't been there for 30 days. No, September 27th, he would have been there for 30 days. So I don't know. But, either way, we've got him. And I think for a number 5 on the depth chart,
it can't hurt.
He can't hurt. I don't think we'll ever see him in a Flaming C.
The only way that would happen is if more goaltender injuries and or multiple trades, and I don't see either scenario.
No, I mean, even if you have multiple trades, let's assume you get rid of Ramo.
And Hiller.
I think that you bring in, Ortio gets a start. You might keep Gillies in the A at that point just to get more play time. So, yeah, maybe he'd become the backup, but I don't know. I could also see the Flames just signing some UFA at that point.
Yeah.
Or getting another AHL goalie in one of the trades. But, yeah, no, I think he's definitely number 5 on the depth chart right now and should be good in sort of mop-up duty at the AHL level. But, again, what's the name of the backup that we had down at the AHL?
Ken Simpson.
Who gets screwed again, right? He got screwed when Ramo came down and they reassigned him to Colorado. And then Ramo leaves and he came back, and now it's like, crap, I'm going back. I imagine now he's going back to Colorado.
Yeah. Well, realistically, Simpson played terribly, so...
Eric Hartzell played, too.
Yeah. If Simpson played well, I think that...
You wouldn't have had to acquire Poulin.
No. It's just that if... you want to salvage Stockton season as well.
Yeah, well, that's it. If Calgary's is terrible, we at least need the prospects to be doing well.
Yeah.
You know, maybe that's where you see a guy like Raymond after, after Christmas go down there to help mop up the Stockton season if they run into some trouble.
Yeah, we'll see.
So the interesting thing that we talked briefly about earlier was the Flames had a back-to-back this week, and they played Ramo in both games, which usually you don't do. And I think we saw the effects of that in the Chicago game when he didn't look like himself. I think he was probably exhausted. What does it say to you, Matt, that we have back-to-backs and the Flames don't... I mean, yes, Ramo looked good in the first one, but you don't even give Ortio a chance where that's the backup's job, is to play the back-to-back. Does that tell you that the Flames coaching staff has lost confidence in Joni Ortio?
Yes, and honestly, I would not expect Ortio back at this point in the organization, because if I'm Ortio, I look at how the Flames have handled him over the years.
I wouldn't come back.
No. And they've treated him like dirt pretty much the last few years. And yeah, you can't give a guy one and like partial of two other games and say, oh, well, you had your chance.
I don't know if I'd say they've treated him like dirt the last couple of years. I think they've given him what he needed. And a couple of years ago, he started in the ECHL because that's what he needed. He needed to get out of a slow start. I think they've treated him fairly well, but they've been touting him as the goalie of the future. And now they bring him to the NHL, they put him on the roster, and they're not playing him like he's the goalie of the future. And even now, when our season looks like it's slipping away, now to me is when you start giving Ortio starts, because why not, right? I mean, you're, again, if we're in development mode, develop him. But I'm not sure if he'll stick around as a backup or if the Flames are looking to move three goaltenders now. But to me, when I saw they didn't get that start, I thought, well, Ortio's supposed to be, you know, our next goalie, and maybe Gillies has leapfrogged him in the depth chart, but I'm almost wondering if at this point you try putting him on waivers and see if you can get him through.
Yeah, and I think at this point you would, because of his poor start. And
even with Kevin Poulin down there, you make Ortio the starter and Poulin will back him up.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. Like, if the Flames have lost that much confidence in Ortio, and with Hiller coming back, why? I mean, you know, if you're not going to play him in the NHL, play him somewhere else. Give him AHL play. And if he's really that bad to you, let somebody else take him.
Yeah. And realistically, there's probably 60, 65 goaltenders that can play an NHL level game. So if after this season you have to make wholesale changes and get two different goalies in, that should be possible. Like, we've seen teams at the draft, like, there was like four or five goalies that were dealt then. Maybe you trade some picks for a goalie or some of the prospects or a player. But yeah, if they're not going to give Ortio a legitimate shot, then either send him to Stockton or just, yeah.
See, again, looking that we're in a rebuild, I think we very quickly have to find a young goaltender to be our goalie of the future. We found our forge of the future. We found our defenseman. I think the Flames very quickly have to decide who that goalie is going to be. And if it's not Ortio, then it has to be Gillies, or we have to go acquire that guy. I don't know that we can go out to UFA or to the draft and make a trade for another veteran goalie. I think if, you know, if we're going to weather this storm through a rebuild, we got to rebuild from the net out. And if Ortio's not the guy, then, you know, send Ortio down, do what you got to do with the vets, and maybe when the dust settles, Ortio's the AHL goalie and Gillies is the NHL goalie.
Yeah. And
but to me, I don't know that going out and getting a Cam Ward or, you know, somebody else, I just use his name because it's been floated as an available goalie and he's a UFA at the end of the year, but I don't know that bringing in another veteran solves the problem.
No, it's only a stopgap. Really.
Exactly. If we were a playoff team, it'd be necessary. But if we're going to rebuild, let's rebuild all the way and let's find that guy.
Yeah, and that's why when you're going into a rebuild, realistically, you should spend at least one draft pick every draft on a goaltender until you find your guy. And sometimes you get lucky. Like San Jose in 94, they got Nabokov, Toskala, Kipper, and Hedberg all in the same draft. And you know, all four of them ended up being starters at some point or another.
And we were actually the benefactor of them having too much goalie talent.
Exactly. And the Flames have four guys in the farm system that are young goalies. And I would not be opposed to getting another one or two until you have that guy. And then once you do have that guy, then you can trade off the other guys.
So you were saying how Ortio probably won't come back. I wouldn't be surprised if Ramo doesn't come back.
I honestly don't think any of the Flames goaltenders that are in the NHL right now are going to be wearing a Flaming C next year.
No, I can't see Ramo even talking to the team. I mean, I think he did them a big favor this summer by coming back on a 1 year. I think that Hiller is past his prime. I think it's time for him to go. So, yeah, you've really got to decide now. Is it Ortio, Gillies, or Poulin?
Mm-hmm.
Who's our goalie of the future? There's nobody else. I mean, Mason McDonald's a couple years from being ready. It's not him yet. And I'm not sure that he's better than the other options.
Yeah. And then you got Nick Schneider, who's 18. So that's still a ways away.
But I think that if we were to go out and pay for somebody and make a trade, I don't know that I'd want to pay the cost to acquire that young goaltender.
No. Like, if you look at what San Jose paid to get Jones, like, I wouldn't want to spend that amount.
Exactly. So I think we have
like a first and a decent prospect. So, you know, that's why, like, if the Flames did go, I think what you would do is just sign a UFA and just call it a day at that point.
I think if you sign a UFA, you'd have to sign them assuming they're going to be the backup. And you'd say do a a UFA and Gillies, and give Gillies the chance to lose the job.
Yeah.
Or Ortio, or whoever you're going to go with. You say, all right, young guy, this is your net to lose. But if you do, we got somebody who knows what they're doing sitting in the wings ready to take it.
Yeah, sort of like Buffalo with having Chad Johnson there and Robin Leonard, you're the guy, and then he got hurt, but same effect.
Pretty much, yeah, because you'd hate for next year for us to be doing better, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, but now our goaltending's crap again, and we got two young kids who don't know what they're doing. So I think, yeah, if we are going to bring in a UFA, we can't spend nearly as much as we are now, but yeah, bring a guy in, tell him, you got to earn the net, but, you know, this young guy gets first crack at it because we're a rebuilding team. So, but I think the Flames have to decide who that is, and I'm a little bit I still think Ortio could be the guy. I don't think Ortio's been given the chance, really, with the way the team has played in front of him. I don't think Ortio's really been given a fair shake this year to show what he does or doesn't have, but based on his previous body of work, I still think Ortio could be, the next Flames starter.
Yeah. Oh, same here. It's just that, I don't know if he will want to come back.
No.
It's sort of like how Leland Irving left and just went overseas.
Yeah, well, Leland Irving was not going to be our next starter either. So.
No, but he is actually playing well in the AHL, oddly enough, this season. But that's neither here nor there.
So I'm just hoping the Flames will give Ortio some chances down the road here once they decide that the playoffs are out of reach.
Yeah.
And I'd like to see him. I mean, I'd like to see him getting in every third game if he can. And speaking of every third game, he's going to have one more guy to compete with again because Hiller's ready to come back.
Yeah. The three-headed monster returns.
You got to be thrilled about this one, Matt.
Oh, yeah.
You've been wanting the Flames to solve this all year, and Hiller's coming back. He practiced with the team today, and the Flames saying he may be back in action as early as the Devils game later this week.
Yep, and the Flames just need to figure out who their guy is and run with them and get rid of the other guy, leaving Ortio as the backup. And
do you think that Ramo gets reassigned when Hiller comes back?
That would be really mean. After how well he's played the past
week.
Thanks
for coming in and bail us out.
You've played really well since you've been back here, but, you know.
You are the weakest link. Goodbye.
Yeah. You know, that would be really tough to do, but.
Do you think they waive Hiller?
I could see that happening. I think you give Hiller a game or two, and if he's playing as badly as he did beforehand, then you just put him on waivers and he becomes the weakest link.
I think one of these guys has to be waived, and as much as I didn't think so earlier in the year with his poor play and the poor play of the Flames so far, I think if they wanted to, you could sneak Ortio through waivers at this point.
Same here. I think everybody's got their goaltending tandem set, and with how Ortio's struggled, just like all the other Flames goalies, I think that he would clear.
Yeah,
I don't think he would have if they tried to put him on waivers when Poulin was, but now I think we're far enough into the season where teams are probably not as apt to claim a guy.
Well, and is it?
Especially because they have to keep him on the team all year, and that they already have their goaltending tandem sorted out.
Well, and that's exactly what I was going to say, is as I mentioned to you earlier, earlier in the season, I think that one of the things that the Flames would have going in their favor there is if the guy gets picked up off waivers, you can't send him to the AHL. I mean, you can, but the Flames just take him back if they waived him.
Yeah.
So you pretty much got to keep him at the NHL level, and I can't see a team at this point who says this guy's better than one of our top two.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you look at his performance so far. So, yeah, I think you could sneak him through. If I were the Flames, I might try to sneak two of them through. I might put Hiller and Ortio up, and, you know, if they both clear, it gives you some options.
Yeah.
If we lose them both, well, Poulin, you got your NHL job.
Yeah. That'd be a little weird, but yeah.
But again, I can't see two teams saying, you know what, Hiller with his big contract, let's bring him in. Or, you know, and let's take Ortio as well. So I think you'd get one on through.
Yeah, we'll see.
Do you think that Hiller gets a start this week?
Yeah, I think that he will get at least one of the starts. I would probably start him against New Jersey.
If he's healthy?
Yeah, just to give him a taste of the ice again. Like, Ramo, he's played a lot lately.
See, I'd go the other way because the other game this week, Chicago, and Chicago's now lit Ramo up. So I'd almost give him a different goalie, just see if we can throw him off a bit.
Yeah, well, I'd actually give both games to Hiller. So
okay,
that
yeah.
way you could make the decision on... Like, if Hiller stinks up the joint in both games, then you waive him. If not, you just assign Ramo.
Yeah, no, that could be. But, yeah, I would play Hiller at least against Chicago because I don't think it's fair to put Ramo in that line of fire again. And I also think shaking it up might give you a bit of an advantage. And you know what? At this point, I think if I was the Flames, I would probably give Ortio the New Jersey game.
Yeah.
I mean, it can't hurt, right? Let's try something new.
We'll see.
So, but I'm glad that Hiller's coming back. That looked like it could have been a bad injury when he went down. So I'm glad that he's coming back. But, yeah, the Flames have got to do something now with the goaltending. I mean, it was one of those things of, oh, good, we happen to have an extra goalie around. It's okay. You know, we can make do without Hiller. And good for Ramo. I thought that whole thing was funny that he got sent down and then, like, a game later he comes back up. But, yeah, you're right. You can't say to him now, hey, thanks for bailing us out. You're on your way back.
Yeah, you finally sorted out yourself and are playing better, so now we're going to get rid of you.
You've won a few games for us. Thanks, but no thanks.
Yeah.
And, you know, and yeah, you're right. I think that now it's Hiller's turn to prove himself and say, it's Ramo's net. Take it back, or, you know, you're going to be going to the A. He'd probably be the most expensive AHL goalie.
Probably. Well, the thing is, if you give Hiller the start... the two starts this week, you could have a verdict on the goaltending situation, because if Hiller struggles, then he goes. If he plays well, then Ortio goes.
Yeah, no, you're right. That could be a good way to do it.
Because you know what Ramo's doing, and he's played well recently, so, you know, he's more or less figured out.
We now have enough of a body of work of Karri Ramo to be able to evaluate him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we had that earlier when he got sent down, but I think now we have a body of work from this season to evaluate Karri Ramo by. Well, there's one other transaction that happened, and it happened earlier today. The Flames decided to send Derek Grant back to the AHL, to Stockton. This was the only call-up of the season so far, and to be honest, we were surprised when he came up, and I'm surprised how long he stayed here. I imagine this is just a routine move. He's played 9 games so far, so if he played tomorrow against New Jersey, it would be his 10th game, which means that he'd no longer be waiver eligible. So I think this is just a roster management move. But to me, he should have stuck around, and a guy like Mason Raymond should have been sent down. I'm a little bit surprised with the always earned, never given mantra that Grant is going down.
Exactly, and especially with how poorly the Flames have done in faceoffs since... basically the last 15 years, having somebody that can win draws reliably like Grant, that was something that Calgary was sorely lacking. And even though Grant didn't really contribute much outside of that, other than some solid defensive play, having the availability of someone that can actually win faceoffs was, I think, something that the Flames needed a lot more than either a guy like Brandon Bollig or Mason Raymond, who are just there. And
I think Grant has done sort of not, you know, exact same, but I think he's filled some of the energy we've lost from Boma.
Yeah, I can agree with
him
that.
Sort of play that gritty player. You know, obviously he's not taken over. Yeah, one for one for what we lost. But I think that he came in and he said, this is something the Flames are lacking. And he stepped into that role.
Yeah, and, you know, credit to him, like, he played well enough where he deserved to be in the lineup. I don't really understand why the Flames sent him down, but we will see. I would not be shocked if he's only down there for a week or so, and then he and Raymond get their spots traded.
Yeah, but we've been saying that since the beginning of the year.
True.
I have a couple ideas. First off, it's that the organization has abandoned the always earned, never given philosophy, because to me, he's earned a spot over other guys, and it's simply now just a salary cap move, and that's why Raymond's staying. The only other thing I can think of is that this is the first... I mean, obviously, we don't want to keep him here if he's not going to stay here long-term, because we don't want him to have to clear waivers again. But I wonder if it's the first move of a bigger set of moves that True Living has. Maybe he needs to free up a roster space for something else.
Yeah, and we won't know that until stuff actually happens.
Yeah, and I imagine if it... I mean, if you make a move like that, it's in the works now. We'd probably know by the end of the week.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, those are the only two things I can think of. Because, yeah, to me, Derek Grant, if anyone has earned a spot here, Derek Grant has. And I think there's a lot of arguments to be made that other guys shouldn't be here. And Hartley said they wanted to send Grant down so that he could play more. He said that they sent him down just for the ice time, which I don't really buy. He's 25. He's, you know what you've got out of him by now. Yeah, he's new to the organization, but he's... played three seasons in the NHL. This guy's got enough of a... five seasons in the NHL, sorry. This guy's got enough body of work. You know what you've got with him. So, and interesting, too, Hartley said they may not recall somebody else because they have enough bodies, which is true. And if they're sending Grant down because they want him to get more ice time, I'd rather they don't recall somebody just to sit around and not play.
True.
You know, if they're saying Mason Raymond is our guy... I'd rather you keep all the farm guys on the farm and let them play more minutes.
Can't argue with you there at all.
Well, yeah, we'll see what happens. But it's sort of a surprising move from a hockey perspective, but not a surprising move from a roster management perspective.
Exactly.
So, Matt...
sort of like with Granlin getting assigned at the beginning of the year. It made sense for roster management reasons, and that was pretty much it.
It wasn't a great hockey move, but it was a great roster management move. And, you know, we don't want to lose some of these guys, almost like what happened with Drew Shore last year. We don't want to lose them to waivers just because, oh, well, you know, we kept them up too long.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was a good move to send him down, and we can always bring him back up if we think he needs to come up. But we'll see what happens. I think Grant will be here later in the year.
Yeah, so do I.
I think he comes back up. And if they bring him back up, he's got to stay at that point. But I think he can earn a full-time spot, especially if we start to see some veterans moved out.
Yes.
So, Matt, do you want to give us some information about the Stockton Heat? They've been playing well lately, and we've seen Kevin Poulin play in two games already since his acquisition. What have we seen from the Heat over the past week?
They played the Texas Stars twice, and the Stars were one of the top teams in the AHL. Stockton has struggled. They scored 7 goals in the first game of the season, and in the 7 or 8 games after that, they were basically averaging a goal a game.
But they've also been getting a lot of good chances, though. I mean, yeah. They've been generally winning the battle of scoring chances. The puck just hasn't gone in the net.
Yeah, and we saw in those games that the pucks were starting to go in for Stockton. They scored 9 times in the 2 games. The first game they lost in a shootout, the second game they won 5-3. Of the 6 goals that I saw Poulin surrender, only one was a goal that he should have stopped. The rest of them, like, there was breakaways and other really poor defensive lapses. So that's part of the reason why he surrendered 8 in total. So,
in the previous 7 games, Stockton scored 8 goals total.
Yeah. So, they're coming around. Guys like Granlund, he's starting to put pucks in the net. Poirier, he's still struggling a bit. Like, there was one chance that he had in the second game where he was in the perfect spot for a one-timer. The goalie was out of position entirely. It would have been an easy tap-in goal. And the puck hopped on him about 3 inches away from the puck hitting the stick, hopped over his stick, and it went harmlessly into the corner. And it's like, yeah, that's about right. When you can't just buy a goal, it seems, when you're struggling offensively, and that kind of performance continues for Poirier.
And we saw some guys who've been offensively stunted this season down there starting to open the offensive floodgates, if you will. Drew Shore got a goal against San Antonio. He put in a nice rebound for his second of the year. And Garnet Hathaway scored his first goal of the season as well.
Yeah. It's one of those things that Stockton has basically played the exact same way as the Flames have. Their defense is just all over the place. And their offense has been struggling as well. Like, they haven't really had a go-to guy ever since Grant was recalled. So
this should hopefully help them with some stability.
Yeah, and actually, surprisingly, of the defenders this week, the guy who played the best defensively was Oliver Shillington. So that's some significant progress for the young defenseman. He made a couple of plays that were actually solid defensive plays. So he seems to be rounding his game out a little more. Tyler Watherspoon, I thought, has struggled this season.
No surprise.
Yeah, to the point where I would not be shocked if he was included in a trade later on this year or something, just to acquire some asset for him. Other than that...
Yeah, I think he might be like the next Max Reinhardt, where you can get another team to say, yeah, there's still something in this guy, and we'll give you a mid-round...
Yeah, like a fifth or a sixth or a seventh.
Yeah, I think you got, a fourth for...
Yeah, we did.
For Reinhardt. So, yeah, you could probably get something similar.
Yeah. And other than that, the team's just looking a lot more... like how Adirondack played last year. Just solid. They still have a long way to go, though. And at least with Poulin and net, they're not surrendering bad goals like they were with Simpson. So, makes the team play a little better.
I agree with you. And I think that it's definitely going to help giving them those guys like Poulin to give them every chance to be successful. You might remember a couple years ago, Adirondack was on a good run, and the Flames got decimated, and they called up pretty much everybody, and they had to scramble to find players for the AHL team. So I think the more you can give them guys who can play at that level, the better you're going to do for depth down there in case the Flames do need to make one or two recalls.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at the standings in the Pacific Division, which is where Stockton plays, this is that new California division that they put together. It's San Antonio, Ontario, San Diego, Texas, Bakersfield, San Jose, and Stockton. There's seven teams. We're behind everybody. We have 10 games played, 3 wins and 5 losses, and 2 shutout losses. So they are currently the bottom at 8 points in their division, and the next team is San Jose at 11. But with 2 games back, we still have some time to make that up.
Oh, for sure. And now that Grant is back, they should be able to play a little bit better.
Let's hope so. But we have been seeing decent things down there from Granlund. I think Freddie Hamilton, to me, has been a pleasant surprise. I thought we were just acquiring him for his brother, and he was going to probably get an ECHL assignment. But Freddie's been looking pretty good.
I would not be shocked if at some point he joins his brother.
He gets recalled.
Yeah. It would be sort of like the Jordy Benn situation in Dallas, where he's just okay, where his brother's, Jamie Benn, and, the very good player. I think that Freddie Hamilton could play a fourth line role without harming the team if and when he gets recalled.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think a fourth line is probably where you'd see him, and with the team going the way that they are, I wouldn't be surprised if they at least give him a shot. He's new to the organization, see what he's got. And I'll make the same bad wordplay I made earlier. If the Flames call him up, he'll no longer be Douglas.
Lame.
I think Hamilton, to me, has been a pleasant surprise. Hamilton's played 10 games, 3 goals, 3 assists. He has 6 points, which is tied for second on the team with Agostino. And I think Agostino's been a nice surprise, too, I think. As a guy who we got in what should have been the biggest trade for the Flames rebuild, which is getting rid of Jerome. I think that him and Klimchuk both have a little bit of pressure on them. I'm glad to see Agostino coming around.
Yeah. He's one of those guys that he should be one of the first players recalled for the Flames, so that way they can make a verdict on him to whether to keep him moving forward or move on.
Yeah, who is the other guy we got in that trade that we let
Hanowski.
Go? I'm trying to remember. Hanowski, that's right. And we let him go, so I almost think that you have to. I mean, I don't want Agostino to get more shots than he should. But I think you gotta. We haven't really seen Agostino at the NHL level since the first year when we got him. And I think you got to give him another shot. I think he's matured a lot since then.
Yeah.
Well, Matt, any other Flames news you want to chat about?
That's all. I think we pretty much covered everything in Flames land this week.
It was tough. It's tough to keep finding stuff to be talking about. But
well, the thing is that all the other teams that had successful rebuilds had seasons like this. Like Los Angeles, before they became a Stanley Cup team, they had a really terrible season, and that's how they got Drew Doughty.
Even Pittsburgh.
The Blackhawks, they were rebuilding, and then they went through a secondary rebuild, and that's how they got Toews and Kane. Mm-hmm. Boston, they had an off year, and that's how they got Seguin. So, like, everybody has this kind of a season where just everything seems to screw up. Like, I remember Philadelphia having an off year when they had guys like Forsberg, Briere, like, they're all, their whole playoff team, and they ended up being, like, the second worst team in the NHL, and that's how they got Van Riemsdyk. So...
And to me, it's really just delaying the inevitable. I mean, we were supposed to be terrible last year.
True.
We went into last year saying we were going to be, you know, in the McDavid sweepstakes, we're going to be a terrible team. So it's not as though we're performing where we shouldn't be. I think we just delayed, we're delaying the inevitable.
Yeah. And the Flames need to, like, realistically, the team needs to reallocate about $40 million from depth players into players that actually have talent that, you know, to get $40 million worth of contracts. And
yeah,
unfortunately, those contracts are longer than we'd like, and we just have to endure it until those ones are done.
Looking on the bright side, I think, you know, if we're going to look at one of the... realistically, if one of the two seasons was better to be good in, if it was either, do you want to make the playoffs last year or this year, I think we're doing it right. Because if we were going to be in a playoff run this year, we wouldn't be moving some of the assets like Hudler, like Russell, guys that we'd need for that. So I think that, you know, if you look at it that way, that if we're going to have a good season in one of the two, we're doing it right. Yes, it's frustrating, but we're going to get more out of being a poor team this year because it doesn't make it that hard decision to move assets.
Yeah, and realistically...
There's no way we would have moved Hudler last year.
No. And realistically, with the amount of veteran guys that we can trade, we're going to get probably 4 or 5 top 90 picks on top of what we already have. So that will also help restock the farm, especially after a couple of seasons of having less than 7 picks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, you're right. And, you know, whether it's draft picks, whether it's young players in the cupboard, it's a good year to have for the Flames to have the veterans they do.
Exactly. And, you know, worst case scenario is that we have to endure this for this season and changes will be made. So what? You know.
I still think that we're in the middle of a rebuild. I don't think we're necessarily going to be a playoff team again next year, but I think the pain is going to lead to better. Like you said, we'll probably get a good draft pick. We'll get another star player. And we move up from here.
Well, like especially if you look at the top end of this draft, I know it's early, but there are two very talented right wingers that are in the top 5. So the Flames needing a right winger, if we do end up getting one of those top 5 picks, that wouldn't hurt.
Where's the top goalie ranked this year?
Probably in the 30 to 40 range.
I didn't know if we had anybody who is really high this year.
No, there's no Carey Price type guys right now.
So, Matt...
There hasn't really been any Carey Price type guys since either.
And
so.
I mean, before that, it was guys like DiPietro, Fleury. So, yeah, I wasn't sure. But, you know, it's too bad because that's almost what we actually need right now. Especially if we could get a couple first rounds.
Mm-hmm.
So, Matt, if we're done talking about the Flames, let's look ahead to the next week. Looking back at last week, we had 8 points on the table. I thought we'd get four of those 8. I thought we'd go 500 on the week by beating Florida and Tampa Bay. Obviously, I was wrong. And you were a bit more optimistic than I was. You thought we'd get 6 points by beating Florida, Tampa Bay, and Chicago and only losing. You actually had this in total reverse. All the games you thought we were going to win, we lost.
Yeah, I had everything wrong.
So you thought the only game we'd lose was Washington, and the only game we won was Washington. The Flames are back home this week for 2 games. On Tuesday night, they play against the Devils, 7 o'clock start time at the Dome. Then they get 2 days off, and on Friday, our last big loss, the Chicago Blackhawks come here, and we get to play them again. 4 points on the table. What do you think, man?
I'll say 2, and yeah, I'll say that they'll beat New Jersey. I have to be somewhat optimistic, so I'll go with 2.
Glad one of us is. I'm going for a goose egg this week.
And I would have went that as well, but we talked before the show, and I didn't want to have us both being...
We screwed it up. We're not supposed to talk about this before the show. I don't know. I've been optimistic every week. It hasn't served me well to this point. You're still 2-1 for me on the weeks. So this week, you know what? Looking at how well New Jersey's playing and look at how Chicago just cleaned our clock, I wouldn't be surprised if we don't get a single point.
Oh, neither would I.
I thought about saying 1, and I thought, you know what? Why risk it? I'm just going to go 0. I want to beat you. I won last year. I want to beat you. This isn't about the Flames anymore. This is about kicking your ass.
Well, I'll go with 2, and hopefully we have reverse luck again, and we end up getting 4 points.
For the first time, I'm sitting here saying, as much as I want to beat you, I hope we're both wrong. Let's sweep this week.
Yeah.
And then you and I will be sitting here next week saying, hey, maybe we can make the playoffs.
Yeah.
But we need 2 in a row, and then I think the Ducks are going to be a challenge after that, so let's build up some momentum for the Ducks.
After this week, we go to the Honda Center where, you know, we haven't won in a decade. Woo.
Best arena ever.
Yeah.
So, yeah, let's build up some wins while we can.
Yeah, fun times.
So both those are 7 o'clock starts here in town. I'm sure there's still tickets available if anyone wants them. I don't imagine Flames tickets are the hottest sellers in town this year. Matt, you've been in the Dome. How's the attendance looking?
The last game, there was about 500 to 1,000 seats.
Well, that was available. The Pittsburgh game, too. That was probably a big draw.
Yeah. And even the previous one, there was about the same.
Okay. So still some seats not being used.
Yeah. It usually doesn't drop off. Like, even in 2013, 2014, there was still quite a large amount of fans right through until February, March.
Yeah.
And that's when you'd see like only like 12, 14,000 a night.
Exactly, for sure. Well, if anyone has anything they want to add or any comments they have on the Flames, we encourage you guys to go to firesidechat.ca, our website. Under the podcast link at the top, you'll see Join the Conversation. And you can go there and send us an email or leave us a voicemail. We want to hear what you guys have to say. And I think as we look towards the next week, Ryan, who goes by @76Swanson on Twitter, probably has the best way to sum up the last week, which was the Flames showed flashes of last year's team, but have nothing left once a team scores against them in the third. So I'm hoping that we're going to see the reverse of that this year. But if you want to vent your frustration, if you want to talk about, you know, what you think the Flames should do for moves or who you think should be banished to Stockton, we'd love to hear from you. Just go to firesidechat.ca, go to Join the Conversation, or if you want to leave us a voicemail, on the right-hand side of any page, you'll see a little red tab that says Join the Conversation. Click on that, have your PC mic ready, and leave us a voicemail, and we'd love to talk with you guys.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Have a good week, and go Flames, go.
We'll talk to you next week, Matt. I'm hoping we're not going to have a goose egg this week.
Yeah. Take care.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.